moral choices in video games appear to be on the rise. What began as a mechanic that was young and innovative has gradually become more common and less engaging. Most games that attempt to include morality simply provide opportunities for the player to choose between two or more pre-scripted actions, and the majority of these choices can be boiled down to the concept of good versus evil. Choices in the real world are characterized by their complexity and a reasonable level of uncertainty. There are often hidden consequences that aren't apparent when we make the initial decision. It's only after the fact when we can reflect on what has happened and evaluate whether we acted appropriately or not. If the real world is so complex, then why are game developers scrambling to include an oversimplified black and white choice system in their game, especially when encounters like these are becoming less enjoyable or meaningful to the main plot? Do these games even benefit from this type of choice system? Games like Mass Effect 3, Fallout, Skyrim, BioShock, the list goes on and on. I haven't personally played some of these games, so I will not be commenting on them in this video. From the games that I have played, however, I like to break down the choices into two different basic types: those that affect story or character, and those that affect gameplay. Some decisions you make can affect the NPC dialogue and their general attitudes towards your player character. Similarly, these types of choices can result in different cutscenes or endings. The other choices can affect gameplay by awarding different power-ups, weapons, or other in-game rewards for certain actions. These systems tend to force the player to make mindless decisions according to how they want the game to behave or the upgrades they want. When game designers try and base these predetermined actions on morals, it kind of feels meaningless since your decisions are motivated by other things. There are two games I chose to look at more in depth. I have played through both of them very extensively, and I made a few observations regarding the style of choices they include. If you recognize the song from the intro, you probably saw this one coming. Dishonored is a game in which you play a supernatural assassin named Corvo. Revenge is your motivation as you are tasked with eliminating key political targets in the plague-infested city of Dunwall. After the first mission, I noticed a statistic that said, "Overall chaos, high." It didn't take long to realize that the game is judging you based on your actions. It couldn't be, could it? Yep. It's another good versus evil moral choice system, but it's cleverly disguised as high and low chaos. If you complete missions killing few people, you have a low overall chaos rating. If you slaughter anything that gets in your way, you sadistic jerk, you have a high chaos rating. What makes the game's choice system unique is that there aren't specific times where it's, "Hey, here's a list of actions, pick one, we'll go from there." There are a number of ways to accomplish your goal, and you are constantly deciding whether to kill or not to kill. Killing people is the main cause of high chaos. That leaves you with the bad ending, in which young Lady Emily dies and therefore cannot ascend the throne. The city basically rots from the inside out. Low chaos means you get to see the good ending, where the plague is contained, a cure is distributed, and things begin to return to normal. That is where the choice system starts to backfire a little. Here are some of the things that make you the bad guy. Spring razors. Using grenades.
We're here to do your washing. Not stupid either. Have it your way. We're here to.
What was it?
Normal crossbow bolts. Swords. Guns. Incendiary bolts. If you use any of the above methods, you're a bad person. Shame on you. If you want to be the good guy, here's what you can do and the game will reward you for it. Injecting people with a tranquilizer without their knowledge or permission.
Hey.
choking people out and leaving them unconscious in the streets or dumpsters, in a city that is ripe with crime and disease, mind you. Vandalism, hacking, or destruction of government property. Theft, and... Oh, you see where I'm going with this, don't you? You still commit these acts that most normal people would frown upon, yet the game holds you up and rewards you because you're a really nice person for not killing people. The same applies to the mission objectives, which basically are eliminating certain person or persons. For example, you could just walk up and stab the man, which makes you a horrible person. Or, if you wanted to be a good guy, you could render him unconscious, run upstairs, strap him into a chair, then you could permanently disfigure him with the Heretic's brand. It won't kill him, but he will be outcast from society for the rest of his life, but you're still a good person, right? In a later chapter, you are sent to take care of a woman who you suspect has been financing the Lord Regent's army.
No,
bad guy. You could just crash the party and kill all three, accomplishing your goal by process of elimination, literally. Again, you're a horrible person if you do that. But lucky for you, there's a better option. You could sneak around in their bedrooms, which totally isn't creepy, and figure out which color costume the target sister is wearing. You can then trick her into the basement, knock her unconscious, and leave her with this weird gentleman whom you've just met. You pass over the unconscious body, and we'll just assume this guy has good intentions, right?
Alas, oh my love, someday you will understand. You'll never know how happy you've made me. Someday she'll learn to appreciate me. After all, she'll have her whole life.
Oh wait, but you forgot to leave her with a rape whistle. Just another instance where the bad guy choices seem bad, the good guy options don't seem much better, but you still get rewarded for it. Don't get me wrong, Dishonored is still a great game in my opinion, and it's definitely on my top 10 list. But it's not because of its moral choice system. It uses smoke and mirrors to seem more complicated and meaningful, but it's just another good guy, bad guy system. Spec Ops: The Line is like no other game I've played. Choice, or lack thereof, is a major theme of this game. You play as Captain Walker, who is in charge of a small team sent to Dubai in order to rescue civilians. When this game gives you choices, you have to stop and think. You aren't really sure if there's a good or evil option. One of the first choices you get to make is whether to help a soldier that Lugo claims is vital to your mission's success, or try to rescue a small group of civilians, which is your whole reason for being in Dubai in the first place. First, I chose to go after the civilians. If you do this, the soldier is killed, but you will eventually succeed in freeing two civilians. That is, after you kill a few more American troops, mind you. If you decide to try and rescue the soldier, you'll have to fight a huge wave of enemy troops, killing them all after the civilians have already been executed. All of this killing seems to be in vain, as the soldier you were originally trying to rescue is killed anyway. Neither option seems to really have a good outcome.
I get it. We're meant to choose.
Choose what? Let's get out of here.
In a later chapter, you're forced to choose whether to shoot a man who stole more than his allotted ration of water, or the soldier that killed his family while apprehending the thief. You can fire on the multiple snipers that are watching the prisoners and avoid making the choice altogether, but then you can't save either person. If you shoot either the soldier or the civilian, the other one is set free. But does killing one over the other make you a better person? Not really. In the end of the game,
spoiler alert,
you find out that they were both dead in the first place, so your whole decision is pretty much irrelevant. Further on in the game, you help a soldier named Riggs in destroying the city's remaining water supply, but Riggs himself ends up trapped under the burning wreckage of the truck. He asks you to shoot him so he doesn't have to burn. You can make his wish come true, meaning you just killed yet another person, or you can choose to let him burn, meaning that you personally didn't kill him, but you are actually kind of responsible for that much more pain and suffering. By the way, if you save the bullet, you can get an achievement for shooting the deer, animal, horn thing, but as you can see by my display of marksmanship here, if I had to rely on my hunting skills to survive, I probably wouldn't be making this video. In one of the final chapters of the game, you are trying to reunite with your squad mates. After finding Adams, you set off in search of Lugo. You soon learn that he has been captured and hung by a group of angry civilians. As you try to revive him, Adams repeatedly asks for permission to fire on the crowd that has encircled you. You can fire into the air to scare them off, but they probably won't last more than a week anyway without water. The other option you have is to open fire into the crowd to avenge the death of your friend. None of the choices in this game are clear-cut. The game tries to teach the player that actions have unknown consequences. In the final chapter of the game, you can either shoot yourself or shoot at Conrad. You can end your own suffering or live on and fight more American troops in the epilogue. In either case, I think Spec Ops The Line does a good job of offering a different perspective on moral choices in video games.
I didn't mean to hurt anybody.
No one ever does, Walker. Three.
Moral choices in games can be an interesting mechanic if done carefully. Some problems include oversimplification. Do I burn the orphanage, or do I give all the kids candy? That kind of simplification. Choices in games are not as complex as in the real world, so it's difficult to make these choices meaningful. Choices that affect rewards or upgrades in games force us to act out of desire for specific content rather than our sense of what is right or wrong, as intended by developers. The common idea behind including decision-making components like this seems to be to allow the player to bring a part of themselves into the experience. It appears as though designers are allowing the player to make different choices that give them more control of the game. This is not always the case. More often than not, choices are annoyingly elementary. They do not do much to affect a player's emotions. They more or less seem like a trick to extend the life of the game, requiring multiple playthroughs, making different choices for the hardcore gamers that want to fully experience everything the game has to offer. But everyone's a critic, right? There are games that manage to integrate a pretty seamless choice system, but I think it's better to avoid having a carbon copy of a good-evil system than just to have one and say you do. Choices in reality, after all, aren't so simple.
Gentlemen, welcome to Dubai.